Good morning, everyone. My name is Amish Modi. Today we're going to talk about the Information Technology Act, Cyber Law of India, Information Technology Act, which was originally enacted in the year 2000. And subsequently, it was amended in the year 2008. So, new name of the act is Information Technology in bracket, Amendment Act 2008. So, my dear friend, we're going to learn about various provisions in this particular act and the provisions which will be more useful to the police officers or the investigating officers that we are going to look into. So mostly we are going to avoid the part related to digital signature and CA and the CCA and the stuff that is required for electronic commerce transactions, basically for the commerce purposes, not from the investigation point of view. So we are going to avoid that part, and I am going to take that part in this series number 4. So number 1 will be from section 1 to sections 70 or 67, and part 2 will be from section 67 till the end of the Information Technology Act completely. In third part, we will cover various rules that are framed as per the Information Technology Act, whatever is mentioned in the Information Technology Act, that there will be separate rules for executing those functions or executing those functions which have been given to carry out various functions under the Information Technology Act. So we are going to look into that in part 3, and part 4 will be on electronic signatures, digital signatures, and PKI infrastructure, that is public infrastructure. So there are going to be 4 parts in this particular series related to Information Technology Act. So let us start. Hope you will enjoy the sessions. Thank you very much. Good morning, friends. Today we are going to talk about India's cyber law, which is called as Information Technology Amendment Act 2008. Initially, it was called as Information Technology Act 2000 because it was enacted for the first time in the year 2000. But subsequently, certain amendments were made to that particular act. And after the amendment, the act is called as Information Technology into bracket Amendment Act 2008. So what are the provisions of this act? You will see. First, we'll come to know how it came into being. So it was enacted on 17th May 2000, and India was the 13th nation in the world to adopt this particular cyber law, or adopt a cyber law, basically. This was based on United Nations Model Law on E-commerce, which was being used as a base by other countries also to create their own cyber laws. So India also based their cyber law on the model law which was created by United Nations Agency, UNCITRAL. So just like every act has certain objectives, even Information Technology Act has particular objectives. The first, very first objective is e-commerce transactions. Basically, during 2000 or around 2000, many of the companies were involved in e-commerce transactions, providing various services, providing various products to the internet community. So, but if suppose there is an agreement between seller and a buyer, and if that agreement is not fulfilled, people can go on the go to the legal authority and seek for the justice, seek for the remedy. And but on the internet, there was no such law in India during those times, during the year 2000. Which could actually give them the support to the seller and the buyer. Suppose seller sells an item on the internet, buyer accepts the item, but he doesn't pay. Or buyer pays and seller doesn't send the article. There was no law which could take care of all of this. So there was no legal sanctity to e-commerce transactions. And this law came into being with an objective to give legal sanctity to e-commerce transactions. Next is filing of documents with government and e-payments. Today we file various IT returns, today we file various tenders online, and we make payments on the internet to government agencies. So this kind of filing of documents did not have backing of the law during 2000 or till year 2000. So in order to provide legal sanctity or legal support to file documents with the government electronically and to make electronic payments online, this particular act takes care of all of that. and there were existing laws which need to be amended on the backdrop of cyber law. So there were certain amendments made to Indian Penal Code, Indian Evidence Act, the Bankers Books Evidence Act, and Reserve Bank of India. So every law has an extent where it can, where it is applicable within what geographical boundary it is applicable, that in, that it mentions in it. So what is the extent of application of the cyber law? It extends to the whole of India, and section 75 of the ITA says that it also applies to offenses or contraventions committed outside India. Oh, this is new, right? Because we only knew that Indian laws are applicable to Indian citizens, but no, IT Act is also applicable to people who may not be citizen of India. The act may not have been committed in India, but still the IT Act applies to them. In which cases? In cases where a computer system or computer network is located in India. So take a case. Suppose, see this scenario. A hacker is sitting in Europe and the target is in, he wants to target a server system in Australia. But while doing so, what he does is, he just wants to jump his path of attack through India so that people from Australia, or the victim from Australia, or the investigating from Australia shouldn't be able to reach him. So if he takes VPN access, or what you say rather, proxy server access on a server in India, and then from there he goes on to attack a server in Australia. Now where the offense will be registered? No doubt it will be registered in Australia. But at the same time, if Indian agencies, investigating agencies are interested in investigating this offense, they are equally capable of registering and investigating this particular crime, because the network used by the hacker is located in India or was located in India. So this act gives that kind of authority to the investigating agency or to people who are victim to this particular act of crime have a legal remedy by using this particular section. So many a times while reading Information Technology Act, you will come across this particular word, which is access. Illegal access to the computer, illegal access to the network, illegal access to the computer system. So what is access? Most of the times we think that access has to be physical. Someone has to come and sit in front of the computer to have an access to the computer, but no. Even remotely someone can have an access. Even remotely someone can actually plant a code which will give instructions to the computer or the server to deal with the logical, arithmetical, memory functions of the target system, so that some malicious program is run on the particular system and he gets benefit out of it, or he just wants to destroy a particular system. So access is nothing but gaining entry either physically or remotely, or by making use of some malware, some malicious program, which through which he is gaining an access to that particular computer system, computer network, or a computer. Usually we have this assumption that computer has to have a screen, the computer has to have a keyboard, the computer has to have a mouse, only then it is a computer. No. Information Technology Act says that computer means any electronic, magnetic, optical or other high-speed data processing device. Even your mobile phone is an electronic data processing device. So it is a computer or system which performs logical, arithmetic and memory functions by manipulation of electronic, magnetic or optical impulses or includes. So what are those devices which can do logical, arithmetic and memory functions? Your mobile phone does that. There are many many electronic gadgets, there are many devices we use on daily basis which actually have these kind of logical, arithmetic and memory functions. There are driverless cars these days, they work on computers. Computer does its logical and arithmetic and memory functions, use those functions to actually run the car. So it becomes a computer. There is an elevator in a building, there are 5-6 elevators in the building. They work on all these logical arithmetic and memory functions. As in when you press one button at a particular elevator, the elevator which is closer at your floor will come at the other location. So it happens because there is some kind of computing function going on within the elevator. So these kind of devices or machines are also can be termed as computers. And it includes all input, output, processing, storage, computer software, communication facilities which are connected or related to the computer in a computer system or computer network. So even input devices like keyboard, input devices like scanner, input devices like a joystick, output devices like printer, processing devices like CPU or a switch or a router, storage device like external hard disk, internal hard disk, computer softwares and communication facilities which are connected to that computer also are included in the term of computer. So now you understood, computer is just not means a screen, keyboard or a mouse. Okay, you have to remember all of this. Now comes computer network. What is a computer network? It means interconnection of one or more computers. So network in itself means connection of two or more computers together in order to share the resources. Even a printer connected to two computers is a part of a computer network. Multiple people are sharing one printer. And the use of satellite, in which the use of satellite, microwave, terrestrial line, other communication media is made in order to connect those computers for sharing of resources or sharing of information. What is a communication device? So it slightly says that communication device means cell phones, PDAs, personal digital assistants, or combination of both, or any other device used to communicate, send or transmit any text, video, audio or image. You must have heard the term Internet of Things. Nowadays cars are planted with communication devices. They send certain signals, you send certain signals to the car, to on the AC, to run the engine, or sometimes you use some wristband where your heart rate is calculated, your walk, your steps that you're taking or walking, they are calculated, they are counted and then sent to the server for collecting the data and making an analysis. So these devices are called as communication devices. You will see many of the devices in this picture which are communication devices. Computer system is a device or collection of devices which include input, output support devices, but excluding calculator. So calculator is not a communication device. So computer system. Computer system has devices which are routers, firewalls, switches, hubs, repeaters. So all this becomes a computer system. Calculator is not a computer system. Most important thing, what is data? Data means a representation of information, knowledge, facts, concepts or instructions which are being prepared or have been prepared in a formalized manner and is intended to be processed, is being processed, has been processed, maybe in any form like computer printout, magnetic optical storage media, punch card, stored internally in the memory. So all this is data. So data is which, as you all know, computer is what? Input, processing, output. So in all these three processes, whatever information is being fed, whatever information which is being processed, and whatever information which is already ready with after the processing, the final output, this information is nothing but data. And it includes what? Even computer printouts is a data. Usually think that the data has to be in a digital form. No, even computer printouts is a data. Storage media in which the data is stored is also called as data. Punch cards, punch tapes, these are now become obsolete, but still these are called as data. And in RAM, where the running processors are stored, and as soon as you switch off the computer, the content of the RAM goes, but still hackers are interested in stealing that data which is running in the RAM, which is called as a RAM dump. So even that is also called as data. Now there are certain exceptions to this particular act. This particular act will not be applicable to the negotiable instruments defined in Negotiable Instruments Act other than check means what? There are many negotiable instruments defined in this particular act, such as hundi, checks, and many others. But check is excluded from the list, and check will attract the provisions of Information Technology Act. So electronic check is a valid document under Information Technology Act, even though it is in electronic form. So check is excluded from the list of negotiable instruments which are otherwise excluded from IT Act. So electronic check is a valid negotiable instrument. Power of attorney, that is defined in Section 1A of Power of Attorney Act. So power of attorney cannot be in an electronic form. It has to be in a physical paper form. It has to be signed by the person who is authorizing the other person and empowering him to execute certain rights. So it has to be in paper form. A trust defined in under Indian Trust Act. This has to be, trust formation has to be in a paper form. Will, in which, for example, say father wants to divide his property amongst his children by way of a will, then it has to have a paper form. It cannot be in an electronic form. It's called as testamentary disposition. Any contract for the sale or conveyance of an immovable property, you want to sell a shop, or you want to buy a shop, buy a house, or any part of that interest in such kind of immovable property, then in such cases, it has to have a in a paper form. It cannot be in an electronic form. And any documents or transactions which government may declare in a government notification. So, right, we are through with the definitions and some exceptions to the Act. Now we are going to take a session on civil wrongs under IT Act. What are civil wrongs? Civil wrongs are wherein particular penalty is imposed on the accuser or the offender, or he is penalized or he has been asked to pay the damages to the person who has filed a civil case against him. It's called a civil wrong. So under Information Technology Act, there are sections 43 and 44 which talks about the various violations which are of civil nature. So under section 43, there are many subsections. So section 43 starts with a statement saying that if any person without permission of the owner or any other person who is in charge of a computer or computer system or the computer network accesses or secures access to such computer, computer system or computer network or computer resource without the permission of the owner, understood? One thing. So anybody is trying to access my computer without my permission, it is an offense. It is a civil wrong under section 43A. So it's an illegal access. So this particular section is applicable in cases where somebody hacks into your computer because he's coming into your computer without the permission. So such person can be penalized or compensation can be asked for, or you can file FIR in such cases. Now you'll ask me, since this is a civil wrong, how a cognizable offense can be registered? A criminal action can be initiated against such person. It can be. There is one more section under this Act which we are going to talk about in a few minutes, which is section 66, which makes section 43 a criminal offense. We'll see that very soon. But at present, understand, gaining an illegal access into somebody's computer without his permission is an offense under section 43A. Next is section 43B. I have termed it as a data theft. The title is not that. Part title is penalty and compensation for damage to computer system, computer network, etc. So if somebody tries to download or copy or extract any data or a computer database or information from such computer without the permission of the owner, is called as a data theft in normal parlance, right? So anybody trying to steal data, or anybody who steals the data from your computer without your permission, will be liable under section 43B. Virus dissemination. So anybody tries to, or anybody makes it point to introduce a computer contaminant, which is called a virus, into a computer system by any means, like by asking you to click or provoking you to click on a link, or misrepresenting a genuine file, misrepresenting by sending as if he's sending a genuine file and is sending a virus, and you're clicking on that file and the virus gets installed in your computer, a malware gets installed on your computer, a Trojan gets installed on your computer, and that Trojan silently steals all the information from your computer and sends it to the hacker. In such cases, this provision is applicable to that particular case. Now, the many cases are related to ransomware these days. So somebody is getting access to your computer and then encrypts all the data on your computer and sends a message to you, like the one which is there in rectangle, which says that if you want to decrypt your file, you want to have access to your own files, please pay me the ransom. Mostly it is in bitcoins and sometimes it is in dollars. So once you pay them the charges, then they give you the key to open your or decrypt your files. But remember one thing, there is no guarantee that even after paying the ransom, they will give you the key, because there is no legal way of doing it. It's all illegal. 43D talks about damage to computer. So what 43D says, penalty and compensation for the damage to computer system, etc. So if somebody tries to causes to be damaged any computer system or any program that is residing in the computer, any data that is residing in the computer, any database residing in the computer or computer system, computer network, that person is liable under section 43D. For example, suppose your company gives a notice to an employee that he needs to leave. He is being kicked out after a month. Now, in order to take a revenge, what this person does is he goes and deletes certain important files from that computer. He damages those files, or he just makes sure that the network stops functioning by removing certain cables. It's called as damage to computer network. So then he is liable under section 43D of this act. Comes 43E, disruption of computer. As I gave the example, if an employee, disgruntled employee, he just wants to disrupt the functioning of the company's business, he will just pull out certain cables. He just makes certain computers malfunction. In such cases, that is a disruption of computer services, and he will be liable under section 43E of this act. Then comes DOS attack. What is DOS attack? Now you see in this picture, person is legally accessing a server, and he's entitled to access. It is authorized to access it, and he's obtaining those services by legal means, and suddenly hacker comes into picture and he attacks the server by forcing certain computers to send multiple requests to that server. By that means, he attacks the computer with so many requests that computer's computing power, like CPU and memory, fails to serve the genuine users, and it then just breaks, because of which the genuine users are not unable to access the services they are supposed to access. If I take a real life example, what happens when on a particular morning, state board declares the result of 10th standard, 12th standard? Now every household which is having this student of that particular board exam, they will try to access the server at the same time, early in the morning, and what they find, the server is not working. Why? Because server's infrastructure is not able to handle those many requests at same time, and then it crashes. This was, though the requests were legal, but server was not handled to accept all those requests, and it crashes. The same thing by illegal means, if it is done, it is called as denial of service, and in such cases, provisions of section 43 are applicable. Facilitating illegal access is nothing but somebody is allowing someone to come and have an access, illegal access to the computer which is in his custody. It is 43G. Then comes state of services. Take an example where you are using your Wi-Fi connection, but your password is not rightly protected. You have kept the default password, and the person staying right below you or two floors below you, he can get access to your router and he starts accessing your internet connection and making use of that connection to download big web files, and ultimately the bill comes to you. This is called a state of service in simple language. This is a simple example. There are many instances wherein people will steal the services that you are paying for, and then they will be liable under Section 43H of Information Technology Act. Destroying, deleting, altering information. So anybody without the permission of the owner of the computer or computer system or computer network destroys or deletes or alters any information. So this is also one kind of hacking. This section is applicable to cases of hacking, because mostly hackers do all of this. They destroy, they delete, they change the information. Or someone working in office, he just wants to hide certain action surveys, or he just wants to manipulate with the database and gain something illegally. Then in such cases, Section 43I is applicable. Destroying, deleting and altering information is what we saw. Now we have seen what are the civil wrongs under Section 43. What is the compensation that can be provided to the sufferer or the victim of all the act that we just went through? So the compensation is not exceeding 1 crore rupees to the persons who are affected. So you should be aware that this kind of cases are being heard not in the civil court but before the adjudicating officer of that particular state. So for Maharashtra state in India, the adjudicating officer will be joint secretary or secretary of the IT department. So understand one thing, civil court doesn't have any jurisdiction to try the cases under IT Act. No jurisdiction for civil court. So no one can go to the civil court for asking for compensation under any sections of IT Act. So there is an authority which is specifically was established, which is called an adjudicating officer. Adjudicating officer will be the joint secretary or the secretary of the IT department of that particular state. So he's having all the powers that a civil court has to summon the witnesses, to ask to submit the documents, and to give compensation, give the order of compensation to the victim. Friends, next section is 43A, compensation for failure to protect data. This particular section says that where a body corporate which is processing or dealing or handling any sensitive personal data. What is sensitive personal data? Any information that is sensitive of sensitive nature, such as your credit card number, your debit card number, your bank account number, your login ID, your PAN card number, your Aadhaar card number, or any information that is related to your medical history. These are all sensitive personal data, which can be misused by the criminals to gain something illegally. So this sensitive personal data, when it is with some third intermediary is a company which actually stores your data while processing it, or which has been given to that particular company voluntarily by you, so that it will be easy for them to serve you visibly or for providing the services. That personal information sometimes is required by the companies, but while keeping that information with them, if they don't maintain any kind of security standard or if they don't take due diligence in protecting that information, they are liable to give compensation to the person whose information has been breached. So such compensation can be obtained under Section 43A of this particular act, and the compensation will go to the tune of rupees 5 crores. We just in the previous slide, we understood that any compensation which is up to 1 crore rupees, such cases can be tried by the adjudicating officer, who I told you is a IT secretary of a state government, IT department. So what happens to the cases where amount of compensation goes up to 5 crore rupees, which is more than 1 crore? So these kind of cases are filed in the High Court
and not before the adjudicating officer. So these are the few security standards which are actually followed by the industry. This is the ISO 27001, is IT security standard, which is even suggested by the government in IT security rules, which are related to security practices, be followed by the intermediaries. So this is one standard, a usual company which is holding third party data of their customers should follow this kind of IT security standards. Then for financial institution who actually process credit card information or debit card information or card information or e-wallet information, so financial information processing, so those companies, those banks, they follow PCI DSS security standard. PCI is what? Payment card industry data security standard. This is PCI DSS. They actually follow that standard and get themselves certified with PCI DSS. So that proves that they have taken due diligence in protecting the third party information. And if they are not followed the reasonable security practices by employing these standards, it means they have not complied with this particular section, and they may have to face a suit or compensation like this. So let's proceed to the next section. As I told you, adjudicating officer, all the proceedings will be judicial proceedings in front of him, and all adjudicating officers has all the powers conferred on a civil court. So civil courts have certain powers to summon the witnesses, to get the documents produced, and then ultimately they give the judgment. So these kind of powers have been bestowed in an adjudicating officer so that he can carry out these kind of trials, he can conduct those trials and give the proper compensation to the affected party. And where the appeals against the adjudicating officer's order can be filed, the appeal can be filed in cyber appellate tribunal. Now this cyber appellate tribunal is located in Delhi, and any one wants to appeal against the cyber appellate tribunal's order, they will have to go to the High Court and subsequently to the Supreme Court. So till now we have seen what are the civil wrongs and what kind of remedies are available for compensation and damages under Information Technology Act for various violations or various offenses which are under Section 43 and 44. Now we are going to turn our attention to the chapter which is titled as offences. Offences means in which a criminal offence can be registered with police and an investigating agency which can conduct investigation into the case, file the charge sheet, arrest the accused, and so on and so forth. So in this chapter we are going to look at the sections which will attract criminal remedy, we should provide criminal remedy to the victim. So section 65, what section 65 says is anybody who is tampering with computer source document will be cut. So my friends, now we are going to look at what are the various sections which are of criminal nature in which the criminal remedy is available to the victims of cybercrime, and this is section 65 which talks about tampering with computer source document. Now what is computer source document? Computer source document is not a usual data that we deal with in everyday life. It's not a file residing on a computer which is in Word format or which is in Excel format or which is in PDF format. These are not computer source documents. Computer source documents are totally different. Computer source documents are created in various computer languages which are like C, C++, Java, ASP, PHP, JSP, then HTML. These are the kind of languages in which the programs are created and softwares are made out of this programming languages, and the source code, the code that is written in a particular file, which is called as source code, and which is ultimately is source document, computer source document. So whenever somebody tampers with that source document, or somebody conceals or destroys or alters intentionally or knowingly that he is going to cause an harm, cause a harm to the computer, computer system, computer network. And this kind of computer source document is actually required to be kept or maintained by the law. Like various government departments, like IT department, income tax department, they are supposed to keep the citizens' data related to their IT filing, you know, and anything related to that, which is a source document, is concealed or destroyed or altered by anyone, then this particular section will be applied. In normal corporate world, if any source document is concealed, destroyed or altered, there are various sections we saw under section 43. Those can be applied. This section is applicable only to the computer source code, which is required to be kept or maintained by law. And this is very important. So this, we cannot overlook this particular provision. And only then, if it falls into this particular definition, we can actually apply this particular section. Punishment is 3 years or fine, which may extend up to 2 lakh rupees or with both. Now, section 66. I hope you remember I told you that all the sections, subsections under section 43, they are cut. So this is section 66, computer related offenses. I hope you all remember that while studying section 43, I told you that all the subsections under section 43, though they are of civil nature, they become criminal nature as per the provision made under section 66. So what section 66 says is, if any person dishonestly or fraudulently does any act referred to in section 43, he shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 3 years or with fine which may extend to 5 lakh rupees or more. It means what? So whatever is mentioned in section 43, if that act is done dishonestly or fraudulently. So what is meant by dishonestly and what is meant by fraudulently? So these two definitions are given in Indian Penal Code, and we have to refer to those definitions to see that what is meant by dishonest intention, what is meant by fraudulent intention. So I have given the definition down here. It has a meaning of section 44 of Indian Penal Code, and word fraudulently section 25 of the Indian Penal Code. So all the acts under section 43 become criminal acts when they are done dishonestly or fraudulently, is what the gist of this particular section. Our next section, section 66A. Punishment for sending offensive messages through communication service. When the act came into force in 2000, the definition of offensive message was not precise. Anything said to me, I might find it offending. Does that need to attract a criminal section? I can find anything offensive, anything said to me, anything, any email communication sent to me, I can find it very offensive. I am a very emotionally sensitive person. Even the smallest thing said or a common thing said to me, I might get offended with that. So does that mean that I can just go and sue that person in a criminal case? No. So that is what the Supreme Court said when a suit was filed before the Supreme Court, saying that this is a very generalized section and it is actually in violation of freedom of speech. And Supreme Court agreed to the contention made by the petitioner, and Supreme Court said that section 66A needs to be struck down, and they struck down this particular section. And since that time, no one can file any case under section 66A. So it is completely struck down, no application of 66A in any case in current scenario. Now section 66B, receiving stolen computer resource or a communication device. This is akin to section 411 and 414 in Indian Penal Code. In Indian Penal Code, if anybody receives a stolen property, section 411 and 414 are applied. Similarly, under IT Act, section 66B says that if anybody receives or retains any stolen computer resource or communication device. So what is computer resource? We have seen the definition in under section 2. What is a computer resource? Computer resource is anything that is connected to the computer. So computer peripherals, various devices such as routers, switches, and all of that stuff. What is communication device? That also we have seen under section 2. Communication devices include a mobile phone, PDA, and all other devices which can communicate text, video, audio, graphics, anything electronically. That is a communication device, right? So anything anybody receives or retains such stolen computer, knowing very well that it was, or that person has reasons to believe that it is a stolen computer resource, a communication device, will be framed under this particular section 66B. Punishment for identity theft. Whoever fraudulently or dishonestly make use of electronic signature, password, or any other unique identifications feature of any other person shall be punished with imprisonment. So what do you mean by electronic signature? Everybody knows electronic signature, how it looks. Digital signature is also an electronic signature. Password for everything. You need a password today for accessing your account, for accessing your app, for accessing your email, for accessing various bank related websites. You use password. If anybody knows that password and he uses that password to fool the bank into thinking that that account particularly owned by the person who is not actually owning that account. And the third is any other unique identification feature, and this is very generalized statement saying that any other identification features, what it includes, even my name, I may say that it is unique because it is my father's name, my surname, my name, and people know me by name, so it is my unique identification feature. Tomorrow I can say that yes, my Facebook profile is my unique identification feature because that is unique. It has a unique Facebook ID and people know me just by looking at my ID, my Facebook ID, my Twitter ID. So in such kind of cases, you can file case under section 66C because somebody is actually pretending to be you, is stealing your identity, and that is why this particular section is attracted when somebody makes use of a fake profile or he's actually using your credit card number. Credit card number is what? Basically, it is an identity you are giving to the bank saying that this is my credit card number, and on this credit card number, you can identify me as Mr. X, and my Mr. X's account is this much amount of money, and please transfer or make transaction of so and so amount from this particular account. So basically, credit card is also a unique identification feature, and that's how this section is applicable to such cases. Punishment for cheating by personation by using computer resource. Cheating by personation, somebody pretends to be somebody else when he is not. It is called cheating, right? Not in normal parlance, but then you assume identity of some other person and you pretend that you're that particular person and actually fooling other people, making them believe that you're not Mr. X but Mr. Y, and then you're committing a crime. In such cases, section 66D is applicable. Section 416 of Indian Penal Code has this definition of cheating. It says that if cheat by personation, person is said to cheat by personation if he cheats by pretending to be some other person or by knowingly substituting one person for another and representing that he or any other person is a person other than he or such other person really is. It is like assuming somebody else's identity in this way. Now there is section 66E, which is titled as punishment for violation of privacy. What does that mean? In many cases, I have seen few of the officers who register cases under 66E when a complaint is of a nature in which a female is accusing a male saying that he is continuously following me on the street and he suddenly took my snap. And without reading or going into the details of what section 66E says, there were cases filed. And that's why it needs to be explained in detail. Section 66E says that whoever intentionally or knowingly captures, publishes or transmit image of a private area of any person. Now, what is private area? It is also explained in this particular section, saying that private area means the naked or undergarment clad genitals, public area buttocks or female breasts. So it is clearly mentioned what amounts to private area of any person. So you have to be very specific. You have to be very well aware that this is what is called as private area. Anything, any photography, videography made in respect of private area of any person, that person may file a complaint under this particular act, and the person who is committing this kind of crime can be arrested in this particular case. You must have seen many incidences in newspaper. There are people who actually film women in undergarment shops, in trial rooms, or sometimes in bathrooms. So these are the usual complaints you get to read in newspapers. Now we are going to section 66F, which talks about punishment for cyber terrorism. Now, what is cyber terrorism? Cyber terrorism means our next section, section 66F, which is punishment for cyber terrorism. So what is cyber terrorism? Cyber terrorism is an act of denial of service or unauthorized access or infecting a computer with a contaminant like virus with a purpose to threaten the integrity, unity and security and sovereignty of India, or to strike terror in the people or any section of the people by way which was described just now. So cyber terrorists use internet or computer for various purposes, to create fear in the minds of the people. You all know various videos you see on YouTube which are posted by terrorists and subsequently deleted by YouTube, but till such time, since the time they uploaded it and since the time till the time they are deleted by YouTube, there are thousands of people who watch those videos and they get scared of the name terrorists. You must have seen many terrorist organizations like ISIS, which tried to brainwash many people across the globe by befriending them or dealing with them on Facebook, Twitter, WhatsApp. They tried to bring them in their own group so that they get the manpower. So all of this is used by the cyber terrorist or the terrorist. So the terrorist use of internet to cause damage to the country, to cause threaten the unity, integrity, security of sovereignty of India is considered as cyber terrorism, and section 66F can be applied to such cases. Obscenity on the internet, it is akin to section 292-293 of IPC, but in IPC it is a material in physical form basically, and under IT Act, obscenity when it is in the form of electronic information or digital information is called as an obscenity. What is the difference between section 67 and 67A? So in section 67, the material that is involved is obscene material. It is just a material. And whereas 67A says publishing or transmitting of material containing sexually explicit act. So in which two people are involved and there is some act which is sexually explicit, they will be framed under section 67A. the new section was added when the Act was amended in 2008, and that is child pornography. So whoever publishes or transmits, creates, collects, seeks, browses, downloads, advertises, promotes, exchanges or distributes material in electronic form depicting children in obscene or indecent or sexually explicit manner. So even browsing child pornography is an offense under this section 67B and attracts the highest punishment, which is in under IT Act is 5 years for the first conviction, 7 years for the subsequent conviction. So this is considered as the most heinous crime because children are involved. Children are forcibly brought into this particular act, and it's considered as a very serious kind of offense. So basically, people who are dealing in child pornography, they are called as child pornographers or pedophilia. Pedophilia is a term which is worldwide used for people who are involved in child pornography. So why child pornography is in huge demand in developed countries? You must have seen this is mostly is in demand in Western countries, basically because they're the as a human mind as it works, so whatever is prohibited is always attracted, and whatever is freely available, usually humans are not get attracted to the things which are freely available. So adult pornography is openly available in Western countries, and there are shops like this. So they are not very keen, or they got used to seeing the adult pornography. And when child pornography is prohibited worldwide in every other country across the globe, it is in huge demand because it is prohibited. There was one case, we'll go through this case. Basically, there was a Swiss couple and they were arrested in child pornography case in Mumbai. They used to come to India. They used to entice children, mainly from city areas. And they used to take them to the hotel, in a five-star hotel where they used to stay. And after gaining the confidence, they used to bath them. Then they used to engage them in getting into sexual acts, either amongst themselves or with the couple. They used to photograph, videograph, and sell that pornography on the internet. And that's how they used to come here every 6 months and start earning money in this fashion. They were arrested by Mumbai police and they were convicted. There was one couple arrested in child pornography in Chennai. This couple had they were running two websites, Cute Candid and India Showgirls, and on those websites they used to post videos of child pornography, and mainly the subscriber of that website were from US, UK and Canada. When the raid was conducted, it was found that they had a bank account in which an amount of rupees 2.4 crore was deposited, and these were basically the profits earned by selling the membership to this child pornography websites. Then in August 2018, a WhatsApp group was unearthed by the police, which is known as BB Bad Boys, was a WhatsApp group which has 217 members across the world, and a Bandra-based college student and another person from Tamil Nadu were the administrators. And police arrested 7 people in this case, including 3 college students and a Nasik resident. So this is the end of part 1.